Please welcome the panel on Future-Proofing Cities, Evolutions in Sustainability-Centric Urban Design. Moderated by Senior Fellow for the Asia Program at the Center for Strategic and International Studies, Erin Murphy.
It's a real meaty topic, so I think we have a lot to go over. And to our online audience, thank you for joining us. As the voice of the Georgia, my name is Erin Murphy. I'm really happy to be moderating this discussion with all the sustainability experts. So I will go ahead and start introducing them. To my left, we're going to start off with Stephen Kirkland, who is the Chief Executive for Asia for Oracle. So thank you for coming back for us. Next is Clarence Portmaso, who is Senior Director and Head of the JC, the Digital Import Governance and Fiscal Systems Incorporated. And then we have Adam Domina, Principal of the Industrial Credits at Generate Capital. And then we also have Andy Preston, the Global Advisory Leader for Agriculture. And then at the end of our panel here, we have Fritu Narayan, Regions and Mayoral Management, and Regional Director, South and West Asia for Seaport. So thank you all for joining us here today. And so we're here to talk about the future-proofing of cities, and this is no more apparent than in Southeast Asia, where we have cities on the brink of sinking or moving. So what we're going to talk about today is how the world is becoming more urbanized. People are moving more into cities, and the demographics are changing, the impacts of climate change are increasing. So how can city planners, private sector, government leaders think about preparing their cities for the future? And so our experts here will talk a bit about that today. So Stefan, I'm going to ask you the first question. What are the different infrastructure needs in Southeast Asia right now? Where do governments need to focus, and what should our priorities be?
Well, first of all, the background on the civil engineering background is the ocean engineering. When I used to do technical work, I said I spent 10 years in the basement doing flood forecasting. I've done a lot of that, starting in the ocean at sea in 94, and Jakarta, Tonga, and Chattopra, all these rivers. But, you know, there's not one vision when Singapore was the most advanced. I think the first time I landed in Singapore was '96, and it's amazing. You go to them and see everything that's taking place here. So, Asia is not one speed, it's multiple speed. We tend to forget that there's different social economic strata in the region. But by far and large, I think transportation and green transportation and public transportation has been is a key area that you can see where cities decarbonize themselves and become more livable. If you look at Hong Kong, for example, where 92% of people take public transit, it's very inexpensive. To Singapore, but then you just go to Bangkok, which has six lines but only 30% coverage. And then you go to Kuala Lumpur, it has two lines, but it's a car city. So I think Jakarta has one line, but they're going to put two, which then has one. So I think transportation is a key area to lift and just that social justice, not just for the top people, but for everybody, and also to raise the middle class, because middle class is the solution of having economic viability. And there's 750 million people in Southeast Asia, and the world population in Asia, I think, includes India and China. So we cannot forget that. When Singapore's 5.6 million, on a good day, that's not 750 million. So I think my key takeaway would be that, of course, energy. That's going to take time. And then we transition from that as huge potential and so on, particularly in this very big example. And also, this place is fast. So there's a lot of innovation, and some of which we don't even know exists, but it's there. And so let's never forget that when energy comes to the site to do something, they usually do it, and they usually quite quickly. So probably what I hope. Really interesting for me because I get to work across the breadth of what we do in planning and design of the traditional manufacturing. I start to answer some of the questions that you've hinted to. What's the economic value? Who pays for it? How do we do that? What institutional framework is needed for success? And some of the areas that we're looking at in this part of the world is really around that capacity and capability building. How do we get the cities to drive forward from a sustainable future? So I'll probably focus a bit on that.
Hi everyone, Director of C40 Cities, and have looked at globally C40's delivery with city leaders working on driving bold ambition. And for me and for C40, like, you know, what's critical is, and I joined C40 from the World Bank, I was working at the International Finance Corporation, which is the private sector arm of the World Bank, looking at, you know, how do you unlock investments now on this impact platform on city financing. And, you know, for us, it's D40, and for me in particular, I'm really interested in seeing how we can work with cities in Asia and looking at good climate governance, right? How do you now start looking at how, you know, the city's growth and development and then ensuring that every dollar that they're spending is from a climate lens? So not kind of looking at climate change and governance separately, and, you know, really looking at structuring data-driven, evidence-based climate action plans that are driving decisions for city leaders and delivering actions on ground that are inclusive and are built around equity, because climate change is a justice issue, and you cannot future-proof cities without ensuring that solutions are holistic and equitable. So that's sort of what really interests me, and I look at the entire sort of, you know, bandwidth of looking at data-driven technologies and their investments, and how do you unlock innovative financing mechanisms for cities to deliver what they're seeking to.
First, disaster in Asia is not new. As I said, it was there 30, 40 years ago. But clearly, climate change future of the just the same way as the classroom. So I think we have to solve in cities need to be better planning. If you go back to what I said, transportation, I think all of that needs to be underground, and we need to restore open space. Because with open space, you can store, you can have multi-purpose flood control facilities, they work in droughts, they work in flood prevention, they provide shades and they reduce environmental effects. So I think disaster is really good. I mentioned innovation. People may not know, but they are calling for the first smart tunnel, which is dual purpose for it's a full way into the city. But it's a flood tunnel. It was built in 2002. It's crazy. It's funny. Yeah, I think they don't drive it up, but people forget that it was built for the facilities. And there's, we put a treatment plant in Milken, the largest treatment plant in Shatton. It's being digged and put in the mountains. Like two restorative space. So there's a lot of things like this that we need to anchor into any new potential project. And the last one is, to me, is that we need to try and to experiment with gas. If you think of greenfield projects, you get the Eastern Economic Corridor. There's very few opportunities like this that you can't miss to do something right. And it's easy to go negative on these projects, but I think we should put the rhetoric and see what kind of investment can go to generate jobs, to attract human capital, and this one is investment.
Thank you for that.
That's a good question. And the pandemic really exposed the deficit that centuries of societies had in terms of digital utilization of technologies. And so, what we see as a major trend is governments reinvesting in digital technologies, right? Really takes speed for citizens when they engage with governments, whether it's applications for governments, whether it's in a normal life, or in the face of standing in long lines. Spice point, what governments have seen is by using digital technologies, they've been able to lower the cost to serve citizens as well. So, while improving, but that's not normally what we think about when we engage with government agency. What is my experience and how can I get the experience of citizens? And so, that's one big trend that we have seen. The second is with anything around digital, we see a rise of bad actors. It's not a week that goes by and length of the hundreds of thousands of cyber attacks or scams that we see. And so we see nations more so in ASEAN grappling of how to deal with this. And so these are just the good and the bad and the ugly, if you will, with the implementation of digital technology.
Certainly the ugly is a growing concern across the world. We have already seen, at least in the United States, where some cities have been most vulnerable to violence there. Physical infrastructure, potential for cyber attacks on water infrastructure, energy infrastructure, so it's certainly a concern. And that's something we want to prepare for and not necessarily have it happen to you. Scott, you brought up one of my favorite questions already. private sector, when you look at a lot of global government initiatives, there's always this discussion, we're going to invest in infrastructure, but we're going to mobilize private sector capital. Who will ultimately go for this? How do the firms work together, and especially when it comes to the infrastructure, which is not necessarily a money maker, how do you make this more attractive? Yeah, there's a lot to unpack there. And there's a lot that ultimately, yes, who will pay? It's a combination of parties. It depends on the specific investment, the profile, the local context. But to speak in generalities, governments are constrained in what they can fund. They have pretty limited budgets. And investing their own capital into infrastructure is always the best use of their limited budgets. So we know that the majority of capital does need. Some innovations still require that the vast majority of technologies already exist. What we need is private investors ready to put the hundreds of billions, and it's actually trillions of dollars needed for infrastructure. But those private investors that can write checks that large are typically pension funds, sovereign wealth funds, multilateral development banks. But those pensions and sovereign wealth funds, to focus there for a moment, typically are looking for a few hundred million. A lot of these, like I said, a lot of these sustainable solutions are smaller and more distributed in nature. And while there's not the technology risk, there is a business model risk. It's complicated to figure out how to structure these solutions to provide clean energy, waste, mobility, water, digital solutions, in a way that provides the financial return that those institutional investors need to see. So, you know, on the debt side, they typically want to see a high single-digit return on the equity side, low double digits, and in some cases, on the high teens. And so, who will structure those deals? Unfortunately, there's not enough people out there doing it. Generate was set up the company that I work for to address that problem, because what we found was that a number of GPs are really incentivized around, let's deploy $300, $400, $500 million in a 3-year investment window. Let's sell those assets within a 7-year period, recycle the capital, earn our fees, and then fund the next deal. And what we've discovered is what you really need in these cities to solve these very complicated problems are companies that are incentivized to take a very long term view, who know how to build, own, and operate these assets for 20, 30, 40 years, and who know how to build trust with the communities that they're providing the services to, so that the customers, the citizens, are happy with the level of service that they're providing and providing those sustainable solutions. So I didn't really answer your question as to who's going to pay. I highlighted a whole lot of challenges, but I guess the quick answer is there are a number of fantastic sustainable infrastructure solutions out there generating attractive returns, but you need the right entity to package them up in a way that works for institutional investors.
Do you think that's right? I think that's not an impossible question to answer. It takes creativity, but it's also trying to reframe the idea of basic capital, but also where there are quick wins and quicker wins in terms of infrastructure. India, I have a question for you. So we're talking about future-proofing the cities, we're talking about taking a new year, but in order for this to actually happen, you need the people to be able to do it. So what do governments, what do planners, what do investors need to think about in terms of the capacity building and the future for the work in these industries, but also in order to build the city of the future?
Yeah, that's a super interesting question. Maybe I'll frame it in something that we're looking at recently, which is around the competitiveness of cities. And cities are still having to compete also around ability to face future challenges. And they could be climate-based, they could be societal-based, they could be economic-based. And that's been really interesting because you look at places like Miami, for example, in the US. In Miami, have this $400 billion bond that they project. And that really started to attract people. It's been one of the emphases for growing the city. So it's definitely an alignment there. Now, that needs strong governance from a city perspective, absolutely. And I think one area that we've been seeing, I've been seeing, is that particularly looking at Asia, there is some real gaps in institutional capacity and capability to really drive that city agenda. Now, I'm part of a course looking to help bring some of the skills that I see members. So around sustainable infrastructure planning, getting the right project definition as well as delivery. And I think from my perspective, it starts at that level. Get projects defined correctly, get the right players on board at the right time, get the clear economic outcomes framed and societal environmental outcomes framed, and it will start to flow through. A lot of people also talk about the green economy. And the green economy is really interesting because it will see a bit of a shift in some natures over the next few years. We've been looking at the green economy, and we've realized it should be less about being compliant. It should be more about looking for opportunities and capture those opportunities. And again, this comes back to skills. Skills and governance. So how can we source this? How can we find this? And how can we effectively position cities and even countries at that level to really attract talent and attract capital? Then it falls through to what does it mean for individuals who are living now and for renting now. There's a real strong role for the government there, particularly in terms of nurturing some of these new industries as they emerge. So one of the big transitions in the new industries that will come through will be a hydrogen economy. So that will need a whole new set of skills. And there will be a slight shift from existing skills, but there'll be new sets of skills. So how can that be supported and promoted? How can people who are looking for new career challenges be supported as well? So it won't be all the new graduates coming through with new ideas, but people have to transition as well. Be all research and development, so how can that be supported? Finally, how could we look at accreditations and courses so they can be transferred through from some of the more traditional areas to the new areas? So I'm looking at the skills from a whole platform from starting to development and end up in the sort of user society.
Well, I think you know the interesting aspect of the demographic demographics that we have been as people are retiring later, they tend also even though cities differ, right? Like in the distances of the sort of
common thread of city leadership and how they function. Now, typically, city leaders, and then it differs from region to region, are politically elected, right? Now, some cases they're appointed, and I'm still referring to the elected ones, right? Because they come with the popular mandate, right? They come with it. Now, obviously, they're dealing with just how do they keep the city functioning, right, on a regular basis? How do you generate income to sort of keep the city alive and kicking and ensuring that the economy is, you know, generating the income it needs to, the jobs it needs, the healthcare it needs to provide? Now, in the current context of the added layer of climate, most city leaders, I imagine you have $100 million budget that your city has. You're not sleeping at night because one climate disaster can set you back by $200 million in a day. That erodes your entire budget. So they stay awake, right? Knowing that they can have not like a climate disaster is going to wipe away the entire economic planning can go off, right? So how are they going to look at a future where they are balancing development that's going to get them the political mandate and votes? So that's really important, right? Like, how do you balance growth with climate and environment? It's a very important question. How do you deliver the regular operations, ensuring that they are, they're sort of incorporating the risk? I mean, there was a recent study that was done on, when disaster strikes, our reaction is we're very reactive as city leaders, right? We go and sort of start preparing that. But that actually causes, you're not building that resilience. You have to look at it from a systemic way, that what happens if the disaster is going to come again and again? Am I building my infrastructure in a way that is becoming resilient to sort of future disasters? So, I mean, I think these are the things that sort of keep the city leaders awake at night, because that can just throw them off. Now, on the second point that you raised is very important, because, we've been, C40 basically works with city leadership, right, across the world, and we recognize that, cities are sort of really dependent, and we have seen that city leaders are taking quick action. They're very nimble and agile, and they're able to take quicker action than the national government, right? But their powers are limited, right? Like questions around energy transition, which is very, very critical in future-proofing cities right now. We really need to look at where our energy is coming from. You need to have national governments engaged. And, C40 was a part of an initiative that was launched at the last COP called CHAN, which is a coalition of high-ambition multi-level partnerships where national governments basically signed up to CHAN, saying that they're going to work with cities in the revision of NDCs that's due with the next COP, right? So this is kind of ensuring that the multi-level partnerships are working along with cities to deliver accelerated climate action that's needed, where cities can just come to it alone and they can inspire action, to cities. And I can just give a quick example. Like in Quezon City, I was in Manila, and I just two weeks back working very closely with Mayor Joy. And, during COVID, the basically started this urban farming initiative to provide local produce, but keeping people, providing income, and also looking at sort of the food waste that's generated. So multiple things that came together. She unlocked private sort of land through tax exemptions, right, and provided this land within the city for people to grow this produce. And it was so successful that now the national government is looking at, implementing that across cities. So this is just an example of how the city leadership can really inspire and work closely with the national governments for climate action.
That's really interesting. National requirements, but with your tools,
possible at the pace of the general line for it to go at the back of the line. So how at the sub-national level with cities, how are they able to take advantage of those opportunities? How can they work with the national government to be able to maybe get some funding to be able to implement some of these?
I think the NDBs are capable of Lyme disease, especially the RSCs and the NDBs and PSWs, they do Lyme disease, right? But the challenge, to me, I feel like the challenge is not the finances, right? I mean, there are trillions, I know there are trillions needed, but there are trillions. I know we need to unlock them, unlock things that they're best, right? It's just, you know, unlock them. The question that I think is the access to finance, and where is the finance coming? And also the taxonomy of what kind of finance is, right? It's different from who you're talking to. And there is no clear taxonomy. And we're not even talking about plantation finance, which is a whole different sort of thing on its own. The challenge is that cities need to be credit worthy, right? You need to, like, you know, we can look at grant money and finance to get money, so it's unlocking the finance that's needed. I don't think so that can sustain. We need market-based solutions that are able to demonstrate outcome-based impacts and real return on investment. Now, the NDBs are looking, I mean, we had at the World Bank's April 15th this year in April, we actually C40 brought together different NDBs to talk about the reform of the NDB and how they can work closely with cities. And they're very open to doing that. I mean, I was at NDB headquarters just 2 weeks back. They're working on looking at how we can work and bring the city and the national government together. But someone needs to take the risk, right? What happens if there is no payback, right? Or this. So, I mean, I think it's about multiple facets of climate finance. So, the de-risking, the guarantees, the taxonomy, how to make them credit worthy, how do you bring in the private sector and philanthropic capital to create instruments like finance, public-private partnerships, and looking at all of that aspects, right? And I think to unlock this, you need a very systemic change, right? You need capacity building, you need to look at how cities can become more credit worthy, how can they do land value capture and access. So I don't know if I've answered your question, but I'm saying that NDBs are very interested in that to cities.
That's great overview. And that brings me to a question that I actually would like to quickly ask all of the panelists to risk. When we're talking about paying for things, it does require risk. It is often emerging in developing economies. So if folks have been answering, this is a very quick and easy answer. So if I don't start with the answer, feel free to pass, everyone can pass. But is there a total risk of failure?
Well, I think, you know, by definition, if you choose to come to Asia and you don't choose to go to America, which is where most, yeah, and what I do, right, and that's, you know, a lot of people are tending to go there because it's a fairly safe market. You do work, you get paid, and then there's a system that will take care of it. So, by definition, if you're in Asia, you know, risk reward, of course, Singapore, Hong Kong, very safer places, but I see Asia in general as kind of a certain level of resilience where you need to really be able to navigate where opportunity exists. And the NDBs, to me, are there to carry with that risk because they take the risk that the private sector, particularly which tells you all, you can't really take too much risk to go there. But I think every day, if the private sector kicked in, and we talked about, and this guy talked about what people like to front from a financial point of view, I think from what we see, brownfield programs is that's what they want to do. Pension funded level, right? Because even in a risky market, because it's tested, right? And you know how many people use it. You can price it. All you need to do is kind of change actually. private sectors to go into an asset where they can manage the risk for itself. It's a difficult place to be. We talked this morning about water. Water is another area where it needs a lot of infrastructure. But revenue water is it's a right, it's a public right. So you can't charge for water like you've been able to charge for toll rate. So all of that needs to ask my people in finance to come up with a formula for that. But how do you make these assets more accountable for investment?
It really depends on the investor. There are family offices and high net worth investors and foundations and endowments who have higher targets of value and are willing to invest. And the professional capital knowing that they are going to lose on certain investments. You go on to the big city, as I have to say, larger institutions that are investing in infrastructure typically they are lower risk and they want higher risk. So, they want to know what kinds of revenues are going to be in the next 30 years on the asset. So very risk averse set of investors there investing in infrastructure. We're starting to see a couple of sovereign wealth funds and a couple of pensions, some of the Canadian pensions, some of the Europeans, who are creating new pockets of capital that will take a little more risk. But I think on the whole, pretty low tolerance of failure. Shareholders, we need to provide, we're a private company, but we need to provide the returns that we promise to our shareholders. So we spend a lot of time structuring investments so that we have, particularly on the credit side, we are pretty confident that our investments won't go to zero. But I do, and not to use up too much time, but I did want to touch quickly on the point around creditworthiness. That's one of the key things, one of the key areas that cities really can promote. There are institutions set up to help on the capacity building side and also around guarantees and providing the security that investors need. But also, there are other ways to invest in cities that don't need to rely on investing alongside the government. Cities are composed of people and businesses, and we've actually done a lot of investments working with businesses in cities. So we've provided clean buses. We provide solar energy to Starbucks. We've provided hydrogen from cell forklifts to Walmart, energy efficiency and microgrids. So there are other ways to deploy. I mean, we've deployed 7 billion so far across sustainable infrastructure solutions. And there are some of that has been directly with cities like the City of New York, and we're taking organic waste in Toronto and turning into clean fuel and clean power. But a lot of that is working with businesses. So while the city work on their creditworthiness, which is something they need to do, you can expand and look for other opportunities to invest today alongside corporates that have the guarantees that you need as an investor. We've had a good time, so I will start going back to the questions. But if you can, I'm going to bring us back to some of the future. But we talked a bit about the number of investors and the two most significant.
Just in terms of trends around energy and transportation and so on. So I guess we see this big topic around a move to local renewables as far as decarbonisation and that cuts across transport and energy. And that's a big thing. So maybe I'll talk about a couple of specific ones. First specific thing that I see as being really important, and it's happening but not happening well, is understanding the full life cycle company. And that's
not just in the buildings and infrastructure around us, but it's in the products and materials and so on that we're using day to day. I've seen some great work happening, but I don't see a lot around the adoption of circularity as much as they could be. And I think circularity is a concept that's starting to be understood, but then adopted, but then there's some stresses there. I'm going to say some work that's taken by the Sustainable World Bank in Thailand. They focused on small and medium enterprises, particularly the manufacturing sector, because that's the lifeblood of Thailand. Great pockets of work, and what they want is that backbone of capital, both to incentivize but also to enable. So I think that is an area that is not my first example. Second one is net zero transportation. Again, big topic. There's a lot going on around public transportation. You know, if we look around us, in Southeast Asia, you've got 3, 4, 5 examples of world-class public transportation. But you get up to the skin, there's still car dependency. And that car dependency is actually happening in margins as well. So, socially marginalized groups. I quite get that I've sort of had a bit of oversight on it, because looking at that from a conceptual level and understanding how the planning system needs to change to bring in better equity in the proposals put forward. And if I look at this entire, for example, over in Indonesia, that has been inherently designed as a 10-minute city. So there is no rate of fit that makes it transportation. It is built to make the walking cycle and accessibility based on the community elements of it. So that would be the second example. I've got a third answer. No, I'll probably come back to it in a bit.
So I will interview to get back to innovation and technology. Singapore obviously is a great example. We're experiencing great public transportation, of course, with everything that's going on. But city this week and next week, I'm trying to work with the MRT. But Singapore is constantly reinventing itself. But in terms of other countries in the region, Singapore would be a great example, but where do you think they are in terms of digital innovation and emerging technologies? What concerns do you have about this? So we have some positive examples, so we're going to have to continue to move it. I will take us back to the positive side. What about countries that may not have strong cyber protections and rules and may use that for not safe pleasant reasons?
No, I think, it's fascinating conversation. Part of this, but as you look across ASEAN, I think it's Stefan said, right, there's not just one big homogeneous block, there's different speeds, if you will. And so we see that across, not just across ASEAN, but in Singapore as well. So one conversation that we're having just across the board is around strength, like overall of people, whether they're in large cities or in rural and farming communities, because skilling is a key driver in terms of economic empowerment. With the advent of AI, if you enter to this, right, you know, there are already jobs that are going to go away. And that is true not just because of AI, but it has been all the time, right? With the advent of new technologies, new systems, all jobs go away, and folks are forced to learn new things. And so one of the things that we're really trying to drive is this function of skilling and reskilling, right, across the ASEAN. From the challenging standpoint of lifting itself. And so obviously an area that we see a lot of promise is around cyber security, right? Just in terms of essential to cyber security to protect more vulnerable communities like the senior citizens amongst us from people say some of them informed, but it is true. Have personal examples that we provide IT support for with the outside. So I think that, and so there is a strong mix of drive from government, from public sector, along with working with private sector and service providers, other companies that get these into community and to, not just one approach, but reinforcing continuous access to it, I would say is a key topic that is going to help with the conversation there.
That's great, thank you. So, really describing urban farming, I think, is a great example. And I promise we're going to get back to the positive. So here, I'm going to get to the positive and ask you all a question in terms of what do you see, what you've worked on, organic waste processing facility in Ontario. And I'm not actually sure, I'd love if someone in the room knows the statistics on food waste in Asia, or in Singapore specifically, with us in Europe, in the US. And I believe in Canada, it's close to 30-40% of food is wasted. And so this facility processes and takes waste food from food manufacturing companies and supermarkets, and it has a high-tech packaging system and puts it into an anaerobic digester to process 150,000 tons of waste, and it turns it into renewable natural gas and clean power. And the renewable natural gas is actually one of their customers is the bus that is using the renewable gas, natural gas as the first carbon neutral bus in the region. And they're also taking the feedstock and turning it into bioplastics. So waste is a huge issue for cities. I think we're all aware of that. And I love that example. And it's generating a great return.
Excellent. So far, do you have any examples for this?
Well, just like I think if you look at all the Asian countries, world-class examples, mix them in general. The transportation system for me, Hong Kong is probably the most utilized.
I love the
stuff there is nice, but it's NPR system is very resilient. If you don't have treatment wetlands, China is incredible to actually treatment wetlands in its big years. But I have to pick one thing is this notion of circular economy, a very specific into waste energy as well, but it's part of the world, part of the waste is very tricky, sometimes too wet, so that doesn't mean we need to get that. But there's so many buildings that can be repurposed. So right now we're working on one of the largest chip factories in Malaysia. Can't think which one, but basically the traditional approach would be to build it from scratch, but instead an entire distribution facility is being repurposed to host that facility. So if you take the area of waste that you in the process, that's too often we overlook that. So I think going forward to reuse existing buildings will do a great deal to minimize the impact.
Well, repurposing is really top of mind for a lot of cities in the United States, especially as the pandemic has changed the workforce. How do you convert office buildings? Is it possible? And so I know that that's top of mind for the city. I live in Washington, D.C. Most people are not working, but by that it's correct, but you might be able to repurpose.
I just see that if you do it in the cities, 20 to 30 million people is deserving of the city.
Thanks, thank
you. Yeah, absolutely. You know, I think that, you know, when we think about, for example, as we shift on sustainability, the notion of circularity is very important to us. And so we kind of look at it from a focus on the critical. Process to create back from our customers and really recycle, repurpose, reuse, and then refinance the chips. So we made a commitment to really focusing on circularity principles in our product development cycle. And I'm really proud that almost 99.9% since the start of the product we've been from, that has been in our customers, in our partners, sites, and then it's with governments now looking at that, you know, principles and are able to make economic sense. So that is really a real focus from a sustainability angle.
I hope the city planner hasn't taken that. So, yeah, you have any
questions? I'll be super quick. So, I'm going to continue to challenge because adaptive use of buildings is the one thing that I was focused on as well. I think there's a couple of angles to it. One of them is the change in the role of the city center for the city. I think in post pandemic, that really is shaking things up. So, there is a need from a city planner's perspective to say, well, change of uses could be accommodated. But also from the owners of assets as well, how can they reduce the redundancy in their asset? So that flexible modular utilization of space is super important.
putting it together, which helps in discipline within the city on identifying